In this video, we are going to discuss atrial fibrillation, also known as AFib. However, before we discuss AFib in detail, let's first review the cardiac conduction system and cardiac anatomy in general. Now, if we just draw a very simple schematic here, we're going to review the four main chambers of the heart. Of course, we have the right atrium located here, the left atrium, the right ventricle, and the left ventricle. Now, normally, in the normal human heart, the initial source or origin of cardiac conduction is going to originate here in the sinoatrial node, which we will label here as the SA node. Now, in atrial fibrillation, the rhythm instead of originating in the sinoatrial node is going to originate from an ectopic focus elsewhere in the atria. Classically, this is going to originate here from the pulmonary veins, which we will delineate here as pulmonary veins, or PV for short. This is ultimately going to result in an irregular rhythm, and this is ultimately what characterizes atrial fibrillation. Also, throughout this video, we are going to discuss the management of atrial fibrillation in detail, and there are going to be three major categories that we will have at our disposal when it comes to the management of these patients. These ultimately are going to include rate control, rhythm control, and anticoagulation, which we will discuss in detail in terms of how we work up these patients and score them using their CHADS2-VAS score. And we also have several procedures at our disposal, but the most common one that shows up on examinations and the most important one for you to know is cardioversion. And we will discuss the indications for this as well as contraindications to the use of this procedure, which essentially allows us to shock the heart back into a regular sinus rhythm. So we will go through all this and much, much more. Now let's delve into some of our slides and get into the nuts and bolts in terms of the actual details of this condition. When patients have atrial fibrillation, most commonly they're actually going to be asymptomatic. However, when they are symptomatic, classically these patients are going to develop palpitations, shortness of breath, chest pain, dizziness, and fatigue. Additionally, these patients may present with heart failure exacerbations, cardiogenic shock, as well as cerebrovascular accidents, abbreviated here as CVA. Now, this should make sense to us in the context of atrial fibrillation, because if we again draw the schematic here very simply of the heart, and we split this into four quadrants, we are of course going to have the right atrium, the left atrium, the right ventricle, and the left ventricle. And classically, in atrial fibrillation, as we have this irregular rhythm, we're going to have a stasis of flow, especially up here in the left atrial appendage. Over time, this can classically go on to form a clot in the left atrium as a result of this stasis. And this clot can ultimately be dislodged, whether naturally over the course of time or during a cardioversion, go through the left ventricle, through the aorta, and ultimately up to the brain, thus leading to a stroke or CVA. And this is one of the reasons why we may choose to anticoagulate our patients with atrial fibrillation, but more on this later in the video. Now, as we've stated previously, the pathophysiology of atrial fibrillation is going to be an ectopic focus other than the sinoatrial node, which, as we stated previously, is classically going to be up here in the right atrium. Instead, in atrial fibrillation, this can be coming from anywhere else, often in the upper chambers of the heart. And classically, the most common location for atrial fibrillation to originate is the pulmonary veins. This is actually the basis of one of the therapies for atrial fibrillation, which is ablation of the pulmonary veins, and therefore catheter ablation therapy addresses this underlying pathophysiology of the origination of this abnormal rhythm in the pulmonary veins, which are located right here. Now, additionally, these patients are going to have disorganization of their atrial activity, thus resulting in an absence of P waves on their EKG. and more on this in the coming slides. Now, when it comes to the risk factors for the development of atrial fibrillation, especially acutely, this is really going to include anything that places strain on the heart. This can include pulmonary disease, myocardial ischemia, rheumatic heart disease, anemia, atrial myxomas. This is not difficult to understand, as if we ultimately have a structural issue within the heart, and again, here we're drawing out a normal heart where we're going to have our right atrium, left atrium, right ventricle, and left ventricle. Now, in about 70 to 80% of cases, our atrial myxomas are going to be located in the left atrium. So imagine that we just have this mass located in the left atrium. With the presence of this structural disease present in the atria, it shouldn't be hard to imagine that this can ultimately set off an abnormal focus in terms of an origination of electrical activity, such that rather than having electrical activity originating up here in the SA node, we instead have origination of an abnormal rhythm here in a different portion of the atria. Additionally, as we mentioned, thyroid disease, and this is closely related to anemia in terms of both of these conditions, setting off atrial fibrillation, as both of these can ultimately lead to increased stress on the heart and ultimately over time, a high output state. Additionally, consumption of alcohol as well as sepsis can both set off atrial fibrillation. Moving on to the diagnosis of atrial fibrillation, classically we're going to get an EKG in these patients, which is going to show the absence of distinct P waves. Very high yield to keep this in mind. Additionally, these patients are going to classically have an irregular rhythm, and this is seen most easily in the irregular pattern of the QRS complexes. So if we take a look at our EKG here, and you will notice this as we move along in our extended version of lead 2, you will note that prior to these QRS complexes, we do not have distinct P waves. So you'll note this here, how this baseline remains flat. There's a lack of a P wave here, lack of a P wave here, lack of a P wave here. And ultimately, we should look for the absence of these P waves in other leads as well. We can see up here in V1, for example, that again, we have this persistent lack of P waves. Again, in V4, I don't see any P waves here. And so this absence of distinct P waves is highly characteristic of atrial fibrillation. Additionally, these patients are going to have an irregular rhythm. And we don't necessarily need to whip out the calipers in order to note this. But as you will see, for example, here and here, we have this distance between the QRS complexes. Whereas from this QRS complex to this QRS complex, it's a completely different distance. And you will see that this irregular pattern is present throughout this entire strip. And this is highly characteristic of an EKG in a patient with atrial fibrillation. So clearly in these patients with suspected atrial fibrillation or suspicion for atrial fibrillation, we should obtain an EKG in order to note this characteristic lack of P waves as well as an irregular rhythm. Additionally, because thyroid disease can ultimately tip patients into AFib, we are going to get a TSH as well as a T4. Additionally, very important that we stratify these patients in terms of their risk for stroke, because as we stated previously, these patients are at an increased risk for the development of CVAs, given the potential for this rhythm to result in clot formation in that left atrial appendage, and ultimately that can be sent off to the brain, resulting in a CVA. And therefore, we're going to do this using the CHADS2-VAS score, which we will now go through in detail. And the reason that we ultimately stratify patients in terms of their risk for stroke is because this is going to help determine their therapy, especially when it comes whether or not to give these patients anticoagulation. So here we have a table indicating the various criteria that make up the CHADS2-VAS score. And very important right off the bat to point out here that we have two criteria which are going to give the patients 2 points rather than 1 point. These include having an age that is 75 or greater, as well as having a stroke, TIA, or a thromboembolism in the past. Either of these will give the patients 2 points. Going through each risk individually, if the patient has congestive heart failure, they will get 1 point. If the patient has hypertension, they get 1 point in terms of their CHADS2-VAS score. If the patient has age that is greater than or equal to 75, then these patients will get 2 points. If the patient has diabetes, they will get 1 point. If the patient has a history of stroke, TIA, or thromboembolism, including DVT and PE, then these patients will get 2 points. If the patient has the presence of vascular disease, for example, a prior myocardial infarction or peripheral vascular disease, then these patients are going to get 1 point. Being between ages 65 and 74 gives the patient just 1 point, in contrast to patients who are 75 or greater, who get 2 points in terms of their CHADS2-VASc score. And last but not least, the S in CHADS2-VASc stands for sex category, in that if we have a female patient, then they get one additional point on their CHADS2-VASc score. So ultimately, we sum up the patient's score based on the criteria that they possess, and this is going to spit out the patient's stratified risk score in terms of their CHADS2-VASc score. Now that we've discussed how to arrive at our CHADS2-VASc score, let's discuss the management of atrial fibrillation in terms of our decision of whether or not to anticoagulate our given patient. In this case, this is going to depend on their risk of developing a stroke as determined by the CHADS2-VASc scoring system, which we reviewed on the previous slide. If the patient has a CHADS2-VASc score of 0, then that patient is considered to be low risk, and that patient should generally have no indication for anticoagulation. In some cases, these patients, if they have concomitant coronary artery disease or peripheral vascular disease, you may see them placed on a baby aspirin, often 81 milligrams in terms of the dose. Moving on to those who have a CHADS2-VASc score of 1, these patients are considered to be at intermediate risk, and these patients are generally going to be placed on either anticoagulation or, in some cases, the use of aspirin, again, this 81 milligram dose. However, once we get into the territory of a CHADS2-VASc score of 2 or greater, these patients are considered to be at high risk for the development of a CVA, and therefore these patients are absolutely going to require long-term anticoagulation. The key risk in these patients, once they're placed on anticoagulation, is the possibility of them developing bleeding. This can be in the form of an intracranial hemorrhage, or in some cases, a GI bleed, and this is going to be a major concern in these patients. Therefore, there is often going to be this balancing act between having our patient have a stroke on the one hand and the patient having a bleeding episode, such as an intracranial hemorrhage or a GI bleed on the other hand. And this balance is often something that requires clinical judgment and is beyond the scope of your exams, but is something to keep in mind when we are choosing an anticoagulant for our given patient. So now that we've discussed whether or not to anticoagulate our given patient based on their CHADS2-VASc score, let's discuss our options that we have at our disposal in terms of our anticoagulation agents. We have, of course, warfarin, which is an inhibitor of the vitamin K epoxide reductase enzyme complex, also known as VCORC1. And the problem with warfarin in our patients is that we need to monitor their INR while they are on this medication. And ideally, we're going to have a goal INR that is between 2 and 3. Another set of medications that we have at our disposal for the management of these patients when AFib patients require anticoagulation is the use of our NOACs, or non-vitamin K antagonist oral anticoagulants, as well as our DOACs, which are our direct oral anticoagulants. These agents include dabigatran, rivaroxaban, apixaban, and edoxaban. One key advantage of these medications, the DOACs or NOACs, is that they do not require monitoring of the INR, which makes them a lot easier when it comes to the management of these patients. In addition, another key advantage of these DOACs is that when we use these as our anticoagulative agent in these patients, they're going to have a decreased risk of the development of bleeding, including intracranial hemorrhage, when compared to our patients who are placed on warfarin. Beyond our decision regarding anticoagulation in our patients with atrial fibrillation, we are also going to need to decide between rate control and rhythm control. Now, rate control is going to be indicated in our patients with chronic, hemodynamically stable atrial fibrillation. And ultimately, we can place these patients on anything that slows down their heart rate, namely beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, or digoxin. And in patients who have atrial fibrillation that is chronic, hemodynamically stable, and refractory to these three classes of agents, we may in some cases use amiodarone as a last resort. However, for patients who are hemodynamically unstable or who have recurrent symptoms of atrial fibrillation, including palpitations, angina, and symptomatic systolic heart failure, or who have new onset atrial fibrillation within the past 48 hours, these patients are going to be candidates for rhythm control, often with the use of cardioversion. Now, when we say cardioversion, we are essentially referring to shocking the patient's heart back into a sinus rhythm. The key adverse event that can occur when we shock the heart back into a sinus rhythm is that we can dislodge the clot that may have formed in that patient's left atrial appendage, secondary to their abnormal rhythm and stasis of blood flow in that region. However, this clot generally takes 2 days of an abnormal atrial fibrillation rhythm in order to form, and therefore cardioversion within 2 days of AFib onset is generally considered to be safe because we have not yet had the opportunity for that clot to form, and therefore there is no risk of stroke when we cardiovert those patients. Because of this, if we have AFib that is new onset, meaning within the last 48 hours or the last 2 days, then we can ultimately cardiovert those patients and shock them back into a normal sinus rhythm. However, if the patient has had AFib for more than 2 days or has had an unclear duration of their atrial fibrillation, then these patients should ultimately get a transesophageal echocardiogram. Now, this transesophageal echocardiogram, or TEE, needs to be contrasted with a transthoracic echocardiogram, or TTE. With a TTE, we are going transthoracic, meaning that the ultrasound probe is placed directly here, and therefore the structure of the heart that is closest to that ultrasound probe is going to be the right ventricle, which sits most anterior in the patient's thoracic cavity. However, what we really want to look at is the left atrial appendage, which is actually going to be posterior in the patient's thoracic cavity, just anterior to the patient's esophagus. That's why we do a TEE, transesophageal echocardiogram, where we can drop this ultrasound probe into the esophagus and thus be just posterior to the patient's left atrium. This allows us to visualize whether there is a clot present, ultimately, in that left atrial appendage. If the patient has a clot present in that left atrial appendage, we should not be performing a cardioversion, and these patients should be placed on anticoagulation therapy. However, if we ultimately visualize the left atrial appendage and we see that there is no clot present in that left atrial appendage on our TEE, then we can proceed with cardioversion. That'll do it for now in our discussion of atrial fibrillation. We have discussed the presentation, pathophysiology, diagnosis, workup, CHADS 2-VAS scoring system, and management of these patients, including anticoagulation, rhythm control, and rate control. If you enjoyed this video, please be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. This is BoardsMD, and this is atrial fibrillation.